Charlie Brooker.
I'm David Mitchell.
I'm Lauren McGann.
And I'm Jimmy Carr. It's 10 o'clock. We're live on Channel 4. And this is 10 o'clock live.
It's Thursday the 14th of April and it's been a week of victories against the forces of evil. In the Ivory Coast, Laurent Gbagbo has been detained. In Egypt, Hosni Mubarak is under arrest. And in Britain, Simon Cowell's left the X Factor. The revolution in bloom. So what are we talking about on this programme tonight? Well, Charlie, you're looking at the burqa ban in France.
Yes, they call it the burqa ban, actually. I think people think this one is the burqa. That's actually the niqab. The right. Burqa has a full face mesh there. Basically, women in burqas look at women in niqabs and think, look at her, that's a bit racy. Javan knows, what a hussy.
David, you're going to be talking to Shadow Cabinet Minister and former Blair babe Tessa Jowell.
Yes, I am. Yes, she was very much responsible for the Olympics. She was the Olympic minister. She's one of the few women associated with the Olympics who hasn't got a penis. To say, as far as I know.
Jimmy, you're going to be taking a run at the Grand National.
I'm going to be dressing up and messing about.
Oh, he's got pretendy legs. It's going to be good. Meanwhile, not now. I've got a guide for foreign visitors. Foreign visitors coming over for the wedding of the year. But first, over to Jimmy to tell us about the week so far.
This week, the News of the World finally apologised for hacking celebrities' phones. And I think their apology was genuine and sincere. After all, it only took 5 years, 2 police investigations, the imprisonment of 2 men and the arrest of 3 others. A senior News of the World reporter was arrested just this morning. He was allowed 1 phone call and he used it to check Sienna Miller's voicemail. Apparently, Heather Mills has been hacked. Well, that explains where the leg went. The Royal College of Nurses has passed an overwhelming vote of no confidence in Health Secretary Andrew Lansley. This is the worst medical result for the government since the tests show that Nick Clegg doesn't have a backbone. Nurses say Andrew Lansley's chances of survival are 50-50. But that's what they said about my nan and she didn't last the night. Speaking of which, Gillian Duffy. Gillian Duffy, the Rochdale pensioner who Gordon Brown called a bigot, cornered Nick Clegg this week. I'll tell you what really bugs me. A toothless, self-important, busybody, irrelevant political sideshow having a chat with Gillian Duffy. Clegg warned Mrs. Duffy that there was no magic wand solution to her problems, but it might help if she ate less, got new glasses and stopped dressing like a fella. Got away with that. A new report recommends that Britain's banks be restructured to prevent another taxpayer bailout. I know how to restructure the banks. Keep all the money in one building, let's call it a bank, and keep all the bankers in another building, let's call it a prison. David Cameron has said he wants to reduce immigration to 1980s levels. You remember the 1980s, when there was no problem with racism and the Brixton riots didn't happen. France has banned the wearing of burqas in public, which is a real shame because when you bought a new burqa, you just want to go out and show it off, right, ladies? Nice, who knew? Keen to enforce the ban, French police arrested 2 women and a letterbox. Bit of a mix-up there. The Ivory Coast. I tell you, you know your country is in trouble when your biggest export is refugees. And your main industry is selling photos of your former president looking glum in a vest. Here's the rough guide to the Ivory Coast. Don't go, it's really rough. And from next month, councils can no longer fine you for putting the wrong rubbish in the wrong bins. great news. Nana's funeral just got a whole lot cheaper.
Now, this week, the Grand National ran into accusations of animal cruelty when two horses suffered fatal falls during the first lap, which meant during the second lap, the cameras vividly captured an unusual scene as the surviving horses swerved around a hastily erected death scene tent, like something from CSI Aintree. The race was won by Bala Briggs, whose jockey was later reprimanded for overuse of the whip. We can see that there. The exertion left Bala Briggs so overheated, they genuinely had to hurl buckets of water over him to cool him down, like he was the Fukushima nuclear plant. One of the dead horse's owners, Andy Stewart, dismissed the controversy about the level of equine death, saying this.
We all take our chances in life. Horses, you know, and all animals take their chances in life.
Yes, horses and humans do both take chances in life, although for humans, the chance that a dwarf will leap on our back and whip us into jumping over a series of fences for the amusement of a baying crowd of divorcee gambling addicts until we break a limb and a vet blows our brains out because we're no longer commercially viable is minimal at best. Dead horses weren't the only sight the press were interested in at Aintree. There was also Ladies' Day, which was packed with women clad in vibrant attire, delicate shades of aftershock blue and tandoori puke. It's a bit like a rainbow has been sick on Kerry Katona. Many newspaper commentators suggested these women should cover up, like the sophisticated ladies of France, some of whom are so covered up the government has stepped in. Yes, the controversial burqa ban came into force this week, which means scenes like this are now illegal, so enjoy this explicit sheet-on-girl action while you can watch them shoving pushchairs around, buying a copy of Fern Cotton Weekly, hanging out, texting with their mates, driving a mini niqab, having a cheeky little drink. I always wondered how they work that. And playing a game of badminton against a man who obviously wins because he can see. But why has France banned the burqa? Well, with far-right parties gaining ground, it's probably for political brownie points, or rather, political whitey points. Certainly, it affects very few citizens. According to French intelligence, about 2,000 women wear the niqab, and zero wear the full-fat version, the burqa. Yes, zero. You might as well have banned unicorn racing, you mad French fucks. Sorry if you think I'm being racist, but you started it. Of course, some think the niqab looks sinister and menacing, and I'd agree, but only when it's being worn by a 200-foot-high woman peering through the window of the BBC News studio like Burqzilla. Anyway, the ban doesn't affect all outfits, just the ones that cover the face, like the niqab, the burqa, the Halloween ghost, the Mighty Morphin Power Ranger, the Stig, and the Ku Klux Klansman. Yes, thanks to the ban, for the first time, these two see eye to eye. Not that they can do anything else. Presumably, the French police will be steaming in to arrest the leaders of one brazenly separatist community located just outside Paris. Look at them, covered head to toe, making no effort at all to blend into French society. They're like vermin. Look at their weird minarets, and they've got their own laws about being so high to ride. They even think they're a separate nation. Disneyland Paris. Wake up, France, you're sleepwalking into oblivion. Already some French women are protesting. Here's one appearing in public wearing her niqab and getting a lot of press attention as a result. The police didn't arrest her, but they did issue this photo fit. Do you know this woman? And if you do, how do you know this woman? And of course, if they do throw niqab lady in jail, her only contact with other humans will be when they open the hatch on her cell door and say, why can't you be more like us? You should be a liberated woman and you can stay in there till you learn what freedom means. David.
This week saw the launch of Action for Happiness, an organisation that wants to create a happier society. Interfering bastards. Its aims are shared by David Cameron, Nicolas Sarkozy and the Dalai Lama. Great, just when everyone's running out of money, we're suddenly told that money doesn't matter. By two millionaires and a living god. According to Action for Happiness, Britain is currently suffering an epidemic of loneliness and isolation. An epidemic?
This isolation is contagious. It's vital for public health that we keep isolated people in isolation. And how do we find happiness? It's easy to reach for trite answers. So that's what they've done. Action for Happiness is encouraging people to offer free hugs. Free hugs? Aren't hugs always free? I myself have literally been hugged over 10 times. I've never paid a penny. I imagine that even if you visit a prostitute, a hug wouldn't show up on the bill. It's like a mint in a restaurant. But if a complimentary hug doesn't cheer you up, Action for Happiness have got other suggestions. Antidepressants. I'm joking. That would work. Co-founder Anthony Seldon advocates 10 steps to happiness. So it's quicker than quitting booze. But probably slower than drinking booze. So what are the 10 steps? Some of them are obvious. Eat healthily, get enough sleep. Some of them are meaningless. Collect oneself and feel at one with oneself and with nature. I mean, they might as well have said, try and feel a bit happier. But most of them are nauseatingly worthy. Read challenging books. Go to evening classes. Adopt a grateful attitude. Join a choir. They're like commandments in a religion for the worship of the self. Dr. Seldon adds, caring for others is fundamental to happiness. That's so smug, it makes me want to throw up. But Dr. Seldon would probably turn up with a mop and some bleach to give him something else to feel good about. Still, he's got a point. One way to be happy is to stop obsessing about your own happiness and focus on others. Contentedness through altruism. But if you're following the 10 steps, you're only being altruistic for selfish reasons. So it's not proper altruism. So it won't work. And it won't even bring happiness to the person you're doing the things for, because they'll only get happy by doing things for other people, not by letting some moping sod try and bob a job his way out of depression. But the worst thing about this is that it's telling unhappy people that being unhappy is their fault. They're not even allowed to moan about it. For many of them, the only pleasure they get. And until they've filled their diaries with evening classes, given the local tramp a friendly hand job, and finished reading Wolf Hall. No wonder David Cameron supports this scheme. It's telling the miserable British public smarting from cuts to stop moaning. Don't complain about the government. Trim a neighbour's hedge. It's the policy equivalent of what my mother said to me when I was small and complained of hunger. You could always have an apple, darling. Well, Mr. Cameron, I don't want an apple. I want some fucking crisps.